Well, good evening, folks, and thank you for joining with us this evening. We are glad that you are. Before we begin, join with us in singing.
Good evening. Tonight we're going to sing Great is Thy Faithfulness, and I appreciate it if you sing along with me while I sing the song.
Disrupted our schedules and we ended up going virtual. On Sunday evenings when I preach, we were working through a book study, but I decided to put that on pause when we went virtual because I knew there was a different group of audience and different listeners. And so now that we are consistently still virtual, I'm not seeing an end to that in the near future. I decided that we were going to go ahead and be looking at the book of Philippians and working our way through that. And so if you would tonight, or whenever you're watching, turn with me to Philippians chapter 1, beginning in verse 1, and we'll look there in just a moment. But before we do that, join with me in prayer. Father, thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your love. We pray that as we look into your word, that we would continue to grasp further your love for us, that we would continue to grasp who you are in our lives, Father God, that you would bless your word and that you would be glorified in the preaching of your word. And we pray in the name of Jesus, Father. Amen. So I want us to think for just a moment, or maybe ask ourselves, how do you view yourself? What is your overall evaluation of yourself? And that's kind of a loaded question, but I think we all tend to do that. We self-evaluate in our jobs and in our families, or maybe how we interact with other people. I mean, 9 times out of 10, when I walk away from a conversation, I usually go over that conversation in my head to make sure that I didn't say anything stupid, especially after preaching, I do that. But I think in some way or some form, we all evaluate who we are and what we are doing. We set goals for ourselves and evaluate how we achieve those goals. And we might think that, you know, maybe we've also made some mistakes in life, and so we're at a point where we're trying to move forward from those as we move on in life. But I think we all tend to self-evaluate and try to understand how we fit into this world. And so self-esteem plays into this. Are we confident in who we are? But it's important to remember, as we are evaluating ourselves, of course, that everyone was created on purpose and for a purpose by a God who loves us more than we could ever comprehend, and that we are valued by Him, and we are a valuable part of His creation. But part of how we view ourselves can have a direct correlation to who or what we're dependent upon. Some people feel confident enough, though, that they don't need anyone else. That maybe you've done everything on your own up to this point in your life, and you're confident that you can do what you need to in life without the help of anyone else. Sometimes we also put ourselves in positions where we are dependent upon others. Spouses, in a lot of ways, are dependent on each other in various different ways. But as believers, how we view ourselves has a direct impact on the dependence we have on God. Maybe we are too dependent on ourselves, or maybe we're too dependent upon other people, or whatever the case might look like. However that fits has a direct correlation to how dependent we are on God. Humans typically, especially Americans, are going to want to do things on their own. We're going to work hard, and relying on anyone else is a form of weakness in our culture and in our minds. That somehow being dependent makes us unable. But what if, as we humble ourselves and we become dependent on God, we realize that is what we're called to in Jesus Christ? Not that we are to be weak or allow things to be done for us, but rather that we are dependent upon an all-powerful God for the sake of accomplishing the will that He has set before us. We view dependency as weakness, but rather we need to be dependent on the one who makes us strong. In our walk with Christ, it really isn't about what we can do for Him, but what He is doing through us for His glory. And if we are dependent upon Him, seeking Him, walking with Him, that takes us out of the equation. It's not about our strength and what we can get done, but who God is in us and what He wants for us to accomplish in Him. And so let's look at Philippians chapter 1, beginning in verse 1 through verse 2. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, including the overseers and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We see him beginning as identifying themselves as servants of Christ Jesus. Servants. Another word in our minds and in our culture that we would view as weak. That we aren't the leaders or the ones in charge, but we are under the command of someone else. And that isn't an image that our human flesh agrees with. That isn't an image that our prideful flesh would want to fall in line with. But our natural, disobedient, prideful flesh isn't going to line up with the will of God. And because of that, God, in His love for us, brought His creation back into relationship with Himself through Jesus Christ. And in Christ, we are called to be servants. Servants of Christ Jesus. But see, I think we view this idea of servitude as something we are restricted in, that it makes us less able. But that isn't the message of Jesus Christ. We aren't made weaker in Christ. We are made stronger. We aren't less able in Christ, but we are made able in Him. 2 Corinthians 12:9 says, "But He said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is perfected in weakness.'" And so maybe this idea of being a servant isn't what the constructs of our understanding makes it out to be. Because the Word of God seems to be saying something different than from what we understand servant to be. And the Word of God isn't going to contradict ourselves, or isn't going to contradict itself. And so we ask, what does this mean? Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus. Some other translations you might see, bondservant. And when we look at the Greek of this word, it does in fact describe someone who is owned by someone else and subservient to and dependent on that person. But the reality is, God is all powerful. We need to be dependent upon Him, and we are called to humble ourselves before Him. James 4:10, "Humble yourselves before the Lord, and He will exalt you." Again, we see God's power working in the lives of the believer. I just read 2 Corinthians 12:9, "But He said to me, 'My grace is sufficient in you, for my power is perfected in weakness.'" And James, if we humble ourselves before God, we are exalted in Him. And so there's something to this. Because it isn't just about being weak, that we are called to be subservient for the sake of being subservient, but rather being dependent on God, who is all-powerful and who works in us and provides to us something that we could never be on our own. But before He can work in us, we must humble ourselves before Him. And so how do we view ourselves? Who are we dependent upon? Are we running away, maybe, or ignoring this idea of dependency because we have this false construct of weakness? Are we not allowing God to work fully in our lives because we aren't willing to submit fully to Him in our lives? But I want us to understand that nowhere in God's Word am I seeing that we are called to be weak, but rather we are called in Christ to be strengthened by Christ. Because we are dependent upon Him. Because apart from Him, we will be weak. Apart from Him, we are actually weak. It isn't until we submit to Him and humble ourselves before Him that He begins to work in us for His glory, and it is in Him that we find our strength. And so we are called to servitude in Him. Paul writes in Acts chapter 20, verse 24, "But I consider my life of no value to myself. My purpose is to finish my course in the ministry I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of God's grace." That is servitude. And it's not that we're all called to sell everything we own and move across the world in order to do what God has called us to do, but it is a posture of our hearts that we are devoting ourselves to God and what He has called us to. We also see to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, including the overseers and deacons, to all the saints in Christ Jesus. In the way we do church, especially as Southern Baptists, we don't walk around calling each other saints. We usually reserve that name for a higher order of Christians, people usually in the past who have accomplished great things for God's kingdom, or who lived a life that reflected the life of Christ through works that they did. And we tend to refer to them as saints, this specially ordained person who has this godly wisdom and power and who have done incredible things in their lives. But again, we have this construct of thought that doesn't always line up with how things actually are. Biblically, in Christ, all believers are saints. Not that we have accomplished a list of demanding requirements or achieved a long list of incredible things, because it has nothing to do with us, but has to do with being made righteous in Christ. Christ. We are all saints in Jesus Christ because of Jesus Christ. Again, this should have a lot to do with how we view ourselves and the work that we are dedicated to. Not that we are better or elevate ourselves on our own, but that because we are dependent on God and in God for our righteousness, we are made righteous. Sometimes we have this tendency to not fully do what we know what God is calling us to because we're waiting until we have it figured out, or until we're at some level of holiness that we think that we can achieve on our own, or until we're at a certain place in life. But we see here in Christ, we are already made holy. We are righteous in Jesus Christ. We are set apart, and we are called, church, to begin now. We are called to begin now. All saints, all believers in Christ, called to the work that he has set before us. Because again, he provides for everything he is calling us to. He has made us saints. We haven't done that on our own. We are dependent on him for that righteousness and for that holiness. And so we are called to servitude in him, relying on him. He is providing to us in himself his righteousness and his ability and his power. And so this is nothing we do on our own, but what he does in us. And so may we, as believers in Jesus Christ, as saints in Jesus Christ, made righteous by Jesus Christ, begin now doing the work that we are called to in servitude. And in verse 2, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. May we in our lives always be reminded of the grace that allows us the sainthood we've been granted. What the Father requires of us, what God requires of us, is faith. That is the essence of all of this, that it's trusting in him, being dependent upon him for our salvation. We don't have to accomplish lofty goals in order to do what he has called us to, because we are made righteous in Christ, called saints in his grace. And as we remember the grace that we are given in Jesus Christ, we are given a peace that can only come from God, and that surpasses our human understanding. And what we will see as we make our way through this book, as we make our way through Philippians in chapter 4, verse 7, and the peace of God which surpasses thought will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. God's peace, again, what he provides to us is beyond human understanding. And so may we, church, be reminded of his grace and his peace in our lives, the grace and peace that only he can provide. So often we tend to try to do things on our own, in our own abilities, dependent only on ourselves. We see depending on anyone other than ourselves as weakness, but God's word tells us differently, that apart from Christ, we are in fact weak. Yes, that is true. But in Christ, dependent upon him, that doesn't make us weak, but God strengthens us and he sustains us, and we are given sainthood, made righteous, with the privilege of having a relationship with a God that loves us more than we will ever comprehend. And may we be reminded of the grace and peace that only God can provide to us in Jesus Christ. And so Philippians is a book rich of encouragement and reminders about our life in Jesus, and I am looking forward to studying this with you as we go along. And so join with me in prayer as we close. Father God, thank you for your love. Thank you that it is not about us, that we are called to be dependent upon you, because it is in you that we are strengthened and that we are made righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ. And so we give you thanks and we glorify you, and we pray that our lives reflect that. that your name is made known in our lives, Father. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your strength in our lives. And we pray that we accomplish the will that you've set before us. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen.